of the Egyptian Society of Nephrology and Transplantation since February 2019, the Vice President of the Egyptian Society of Organ Transplantation, Chief of Nephrology Councils of Egyptian and Arab Worlds, is also the Egyptian Counselor to the Middle East Society of Organ Transplantation. And he is going to speak about the immunosuppression immunosuppressive protocols for kidney, or Tony Arnoa is going to update us about all the things we do in about 20 minutes.
Thank you very much, and it's a great honor to have Professor Hebral, the president of the Transplantation Society, among us and listening to my talk. And also, it is my honor to have Professor Honeyman and Professor Yad Zaid attending this session. I will speak in 20 minutes about the future of immunosuppression. As you know, in the 60s we had steroids and azacitidine. In the 70s, polyclonal anti-lymphocyte antibody. In the 80s, cyclosporin. 90s, MMF, tacrolimus. And lately we got the belatacept. But it's ultimate irony that the drugs that have so much to protect the kidney from acute cell-mediated rejection are themselves nephrotoxic, and possibly one of the main causes of late kidney graft loss, making the long-term graft survival less than 10 years, in spite of the very good first-year graft survival due to acute cyclosporin and prograft nephrotoxicity and chronic nephrotoxicity, which has many mechanisms that I don't have time to speak about. I will skip the available immunosuppression and go with you to the future. In the future, we need something that will modify our graft loss, which is not good, to have a better long life. And my talk will be divided into four parts. The first part, I will be speaking about the co-stimulation blockade, anti-CD20, lurizumab and FR104. And the anti-CD40 monoclonal antibodies and the proteasome inhibitors. And let's go without details, concentrating on two points in this co-stimulation pathway, which is actually the CD20 pathway and the CD40 pathway. Forget all the details. Concentrate only on these two, because these are the two in which there are some improvements in the treatments nowadays. When we go to the CD20 B7 pathway, this is considered the most important, and the abatacept, which is a fusion protein, has long life, basically acted as a competitive inhibitor, resulting in blockade of this pathway and approved in rheumatoid arthritis. Belatacept is actually its refinement. It is more potent than it, but currently there are more selective blockade of CD28 by non-agonistic anti-CD20, allowing to bind to and activate the inhibitory pathway. And the two molecules are in this direction. Lurizumab by BMS, which anti-CD20 domain antibody, and the FR104 or the FMU. Regarding the other pathway, which is the CD40 pathway, this CD40 pathway was associated for a long time with increased thromboembolic events. And nowadays, there is some two drugs, one by Astellas, getting the number ASKP1240, is in development in human, a fully humanized immunoglobulin G4 antibody to CD40, but it is not effective in CNI-free immunosuppression. And another one by Novartis planned to enter a phase 2 trial in vivo. It blocks the primary and recall two T-cell dependent antibody in non-human primate. And this drug has got a combination with, as you see in this study, with the proteasome inhibitor. The proteasome inhibitor has been long used under the name of Velcade or bortezomib, and this drug has got some hematological and gastroenterological toxicity in addition to risk of neuropathy. Nowadays, there is a more refinement of this drug called carfilzomib or kyprolis, which is the second generation proteasome inhibitor, with reduced risk of neuropathy. And there are recent papers combining the proteasome inhibitor in chronic antibody-mediated rejection. This paper by Iskander and Jason, 2018. And you see how the proteasomib group gives better survival, cumulative survival, in relation to the placebo group. And they combine this proteasomib with the co-stimulation blockade that I spoke to you previously to permit kidney transplantation in sensitized recipient as a very effective desensitization protocol. Dual targeting, and you see here the difference between the control and the therapy regarding the C4D score and the rejection. The second aspect in my talk is agents in clinical trial for delayed graft function. We know that delayed graft function, nowadays we have two agents under eculizumab and infliximab. These are the two, although there are many agents, but these are the two which are going to be developed by Alexion and another one in the ASOT trial. What about this eculizumab or Soliris, which is very well known in already in some diseases, but its problem is the high cost. Has been used in paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobinuria and also used in TMA, but this drug has got some side effect, and we are going now to develop another anti-TNF alpha blockers, which are already used in rheumatoid arthritis under the name of infliximab or Remicade. These are repositioned from the rheumatoid arthritis to be used in our kidney transplant patients. When we combine them, we got a better survival. The third group is the agent for desensitization and antibody-mediated rejection. And as you know, now the antibody-mediated rejection is our ghost, which makes our half-life of transplantation short. And we will be speaking about five agents in this group. The first of them is obinutuzumab. This obinutuzumab, which is a refinement of a drug that you know very well, which is rituximab. This actually, obinutuzumab has been, this is of course the rituximab that you know. It causes a rapid sustained depletion of circulating and therefore B cells. It acts on CD20, and it has been used extensively in different nephrology branches. Nowadays, its refinement, which is called obinutuzumab, has been released recently under the name of Gazeva, which will under Roche company, and before the name was afatuzumab, but the new name is Gazeva or obinutuzumab, which is FDA approved and will be soon available in practice. The next advance is the IDES, or the immunoglobulin degrading endopeptidase of Streptococcus pyogenes, which depends on cleaving the antibodies responsible for the rejection. So this is a very bright idea, but the problem with this drug is two actually, that when you decrease the level of these antibodies, they may increase again after some time. Therefore, we need a long-lasting effect. Another trial to for desensitization is by attacking the area called B-cell activating factor or anti-BLIS, and the drug here will be binomumab. This binomumab or Benlista is a humanized monoclonal antibody that specifically inhibits the BAF and approved for the treatment of systemic lupus and may be useful for B-cell depletion to decrease the antibody protection. Also, atacicept belongs to the same group. It binds not only the BAF but also the APRIL and leads to improvement in this direction. And this is a study with these new antibodies reduced with belumumab, published in The Lancet 2018. Now let's go to the area of complement. And I spoke to you about eculizumab, but there is another complement, which is C1 esterase inhibitor. And this C1 esterase inhibitor, which is Cinryze, has shown some promise in the treatment of acute antibody-mediated rejection in clinical trial and has been presented in the TTS 2017. Now let's go to a very hot area, which is the interleukin-6. As you know, interleukin-6 is a pleiotropic cytokine with multiple sources and targets. It affects every cell and leads to neutrophil recruitment, macrophage activation, B-cell differentiation, B-cell differentiation, and so on. So interleukin 6 inhibitor are the rising stars, tocilizumab or Actemra, and galazicumab or Vidieres, and of course the JAK3 inhibitor that has been nicely presented by Dr. Khalid Marzouk. I will not repeat them, but I will speak about the tocilizumab and the galazicumab as interleukin 6 inhibitor. The mechanism, as you see here, and the action of these drugs, in vivo neutralization of the interleukin 6 inhibits rejection and facilitates allograft survival with co-stimulation blockade in wild-type recipient. And you see the difference between the normal and the rejection. And of course, we have different members of this group. And this is a recent trial showing that monthly tocilizumab for 6 years gives a very good response regarding the C4D graft reposition after 6 year follow-up, and graft and patient survival up to 80%, as you see in this study by Choi in American Journal of Transplantation. Again, the tocilizumab has been combined with intravenous immunoglobulin in difficult to desensitize patients. And the conclusion, it appears to be safe. And from this pilot trial, they were cautiously optimistic that targeting this pathway could offer a novel alternative for difficult to desensitized patients. It is the added, what is the added role of IVIG? IVIG causes a rapid reduction in DSA and has shown efficacy in clinical trial as part of the desensitization strategies. And you know the standard dose is 2 g/kg, up to a maximum of 140 g in a single administration infused over 4 to 8 hours in this specific study combining both drugs. What about the tocilizumab study of University of South California? Now they are recruiting patients and following up for a period of 12 months. And another drug in this area is the clazakizumab in late antibody-mediated rejection that has been published in 2019. This is a recruitment of study started in January and expected completion of the trial in August 2020. So these interleukin 6 inhibitors, both of them, as I told you, are the coming star in the next period, and these are the two arms of the study which is still ongoing. Updates about that in 14 May 2019, phase 3 clinical trial in renal transplant rejection in Spain and Hungary, and in 19 November plans the imagine phase 3 trial for renal transplant rejection in March 2019. So small molecules like the JAK and protein kinase inhibitor, I will not speak because Dr. Khalid gave us a very good review, but I will just remind you that tofacitinib was non-inferior to tacrolimus in terms of rejection rate, and sotrasatorin inhibits multiple protein kinase CI4, but poor efficacy in preventing rejection after CNI withdrawal in clinical trial, and this, therefore they didn't got much publicity among these Americans. So we went to the co-stimulation blockade, it's two arms, anti-CD20 and anti-CD40, with the proteasome inhibitor plus or minus. We went to the agent delaying the graft function, went to the desensitization and antibody-mediated rejection with five groups, anti-CD20, the drug with Gazeva, which is coming very soon, the IDIS or the amfimidase, the bilumumab, the anti-interleukin-6, tocilizumab and clazakizumab, and the C1 esterase inhibitor, Cinryze. Could we go without drugs and go with cellular therapy using the regulatory immune cells? Yes, we have two big studies, the one many years ago, which is called the One study, and the one which is carried now in America, which is the TASC study. And these are the results of the One study. They used different regulatory cells for a period, and this is their protocol. They give steroid 3 months, MMF 9 to 12 months, acrolimus alone continued, and T-Rex expanded by stimulation, plus interleukin 2 in presence of rapamycin given 5 days after transplantation. 11 patients were studied, and the median follow-up was 10 months, and the results, no cell infusion-related adverse event, no biopsy-proven rejection were observed, and all patients were stable after that period. The One study was not only carried in the United Kingdom, but also in different places, in Boston, San Francisco, Berlin, Nantes, Milan, etc. And in this cohort of many patients, they used different types of cell therapy. Some of them used polyclonal T-regs, other antigen-specific T-regs, tolerogenic and dendritic D-cells, and it was left to the investigator to choose which type of cell therapy to use. But the remarks on this cell therapy that still under investigation, not to be, we don't know the long-term side effects that will happen in human study. They will modulate the immune system, of course, and nowadays there is another big study, polyclonal expansion of the human T-regs, by donor reactive T-reg expansion, and this is the mechanism of the TASC study. This TASC study, which is current in UCSF, T-reg adoptive therapy for subclinical inflammation and kidney transplantation, and they have three arms, as you see, and the re-biopsy in 14 days after infusion of the T-reg in the circulation by the different new biomarker by mini-Sarwell group, which is the KIT study. Infused T-reg remain detectable in the circulation, as you see, and therefore we have a lot to expect in the next years by, in summary, anti-CD20, anti-CD40, you see the names again, proteasome inhibitors, agent in clinical trial, agent for desensitization and antibody-mediated rejection to get not only 5 or 10 years graft survival, but maybe 30 or 40 years graft survival when we use the obinutuzumab, which is already Gazyva, which is available, and the IDIS, which has many Swedish and American studies in it, but they need to have a long-term follow-up, not to have the IgG coming back after a short period of decrease, and the belumumab, which is already approved in lupus erythematosus, the anti-interleukin 6, the tocilizumab, the glazikizumab, and the C1 esterase inhibitor desmarais, and we have, of course, the horizon of the cell therapy, including the one study and the task study that we are awaiting its results. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor.